what year? Around 65?
64. Well, yeah, I left here in 64. And I went to Borrell Academy from 64 to 65 because I had to get American history mm-hmm. and science before I could enter university. In 65, I entered St. John's University.
Wait, this is, you were in New York at this time?
Yes, I left here in 64.
So wouldn't this be around the same time as like the Black Power movement?
So when, Black Power would be 69.
Oh, okay.
Black Power would be 64.
But that would be back when, what year was Malcolm X?
65.
Right.
So I got there in August mm-hmm. of 64. And in 1965, February of 65, Malcolm was assassinated.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, of course, I met Stokely Carmichael, who's the one who talked about Black Power
mm-hmm.
in the States. At the Autumn, in fact, I think it's the very same place where Malcolm was killed, the Audubon Ballroom.
Mm-hmm.
I met Stokely. So those days, it was just firing up. And of course, in 66, I think Stokely Kwame Ture, talked about Black Power. And in 1969, in Trinidad, the Black Power movement. But I was already in the States.
So that directly influenced Trinidad?
Oh, yeah. Not just Trinidad, the whole world. I mean, Steve Biko in South Africa, he had the Black Consciousness Movement. But it was a time when Black folks were becoming aware of themselves.
Mm-hmm.
It comes on the heels of the Civil Rights Movement, which begins in 1945 in the States. And it came mm-hmm. up to this, if you're looking now at that big subpoena that's going on in Congress and all that kind of stuff.
No, that movement in 1945 that occurred in the States, would that have been... due to how the blacks were treated when they fought
54.
In World War II?
Huh?
Would that have been influenced by how the blacks were treated by Britain in World War II?
Because, you see, you don't ask me to go and fight a World War II and I got to kill the Japs and the Germans and everybody else. And when I come back home, I'm still a second-class citizen.
Yeah, not just that, but the Britons weren't racist towards them.
The Britons?
Yeah, the British, they didn't used to segregate their troops. And they actually had, I forget where it was... But they actually had a firefight broke out between the American army, white army, was shooting the British and the black American army because they were congregating and they had the black American soldiers fraternizing with the white British women.
Oh, yeah, I could see
and
that.
And they were very against that. And
yeah.
When they told the British that they had to segregate their bars and stuff, right? What some of the British did, they put up a sign saying blacks only.
Isn't that right?
Yeah,
that
and right? Of course, all the white British will go in like normal because they don't have a problem.
So
the white Americans ended up segregating themselves out of the establishments that they wanted segregated.
Kristen, I don't know that. Yeah. Thanks for that.
That actually ended up culminating, reaching a climax when they had a firefight with American troops firing on their friendly British and American people.
I am aware.
Yeah, so it's interesting stuff.
So I was there, 65. You have the passage of the Civil Rights Act, I think.
Mm-hmm.
The Civil Rights Act is 65 under Johnston. Then you have the other act that comes up, and I got back here in 60. Then when I got back here in 68 for just on vacation for the mm-hmm. summer, and then 69, I begin the marches with Dag and those guys begin to take place.
All right, so you would have been in those marches with Dagger?
I wouldn't know. I didn't join the marches. I would mm-hmm. view it because I would come just sporadically
mm-hmm.
and I would see it, but I would not have been participating in it. I wouldn't be here. I was just here for the summer.
Mm-hmm.
The summer of, say, I think 68, that's the year before I graduated.
So how would this have influenced you on a personal level?
It would influence me in the sense that when you're in Trinidad growing up, you're not aware of your blackness.
Yeah, because clearly now you're very for black empowerment.
Yeah.
You know, so was it around this time that you started being awakened to it and started realizing that, you know, this is the purpose that I must...
This is my purpose, but mm-hmm. I'm saying while you're growing up, you're not aware of your blackness.
Mm-hmm.
You know you're black, but, you know, when everybody black, blackness don't mean anything. When everybody blackness don't mean nothing. So we're all black, but when you go to the States and people begin to treat you differently, you can't get a job because you're black. I worked at Fordham and... I was a student at Fordham University, and they had on the board, openings at Macy for students, university students. And I go get a job, and they said, "Who are you?" I said, "Well, I come from Fordham, and so you had jobs." "Oh, that's all right." And so I take the test, and I come back. It was overflown. They said that I was overqualified.
Mm-hmm.
So you begin to go somebody to throw the money at you.
Yeah.
Accustomed to that here. Even though something as a haircut.
Mm.
The first haircut I got, I was on Flatbush Avenue. I went to get in 64 or so. And it was an Italian barber. They can cut my hair. They were cutting it up and cutting it up. So I know that they started going to look for a black barber.
Yeah.
Because the white guys could, I'm sure they could do it now, but I'm saying then they couldn't cut and wouldn't cut black hair. So all those made you aware of your blackness, even at school, how they would treat you. When I went to St. John, or probably Fordham, they only had about 20 black students in the whole school. So we began to fight for more black students. And then I came up in 1969, they wanted to have black studies because they were teaching nothing that was black in the schools. So that we began now to fight for black studies. And that's where I became an instructor in black studies. And of course, it was a growing sense and growing awareness of your blackness. And of course, that would be the kind of